Entrepreneurs Board of Investors is challenging America to pitch the next big idea during a 60-second elevator ride.
Time's up.
I've worked so hard for this.
I don't even know if he wants to invest.
What a chicken.
You called me a chicken. You attacked me.
If the pitch fails...
You guys ready to vote?
That's four no's. We got to send her down.
Going down.
But if the pitch is successful...
Looks like we have four yeses. Let's open the doors.
Welcome to the boardroom.
Elevator pitch. Let's go!
We've got a deal.
Woo!
Your synapses are clearly firing.
Is the next billion-dollar idea on its way up? This is Entrepreneur Elevator Pitch.
Going up.
Who's here to make some serious money? Let's hear the first pitch.
Your 60 seconds begins now. Going up.
My name is Matt Feldman, and I'm the founder and CEO of Moku Foods. We're launching a plant-based jerky that looks like bacon, tastes like jerky, but made from mushrooms. Last year, we partnered with one of the top plant-based chefs in the world, and we spent 6 months in the kitchen crafting the perfect plant-based jerky that tastes phenomenal, has a clean label, and is free of the top eight allergens like gluten and soy. Since then, we've assembled an amazing team. We have a production facility outside of Southern California, and we got into a program in Amazon that accepts around a couple, 2 to 3 emerging food brands each year, and they equip you with the right resources and personnel to crush it on Amazon. We kicked off our fundraising last month. We're raising $1 million at a $4 million valuation using the Post Money Safe and a 20% discount. And we're finalizing our lead investor, which put in $750K. And we're looking to raise another $250K to finish the round.
Two.
Who wants to try it?
One.
A lot of good stuff there.
A lot of good. Amazon is crushing it, he said, right?
Lead investor already put 750 in. Easy to follow.
Yeah, and I think of next generation food, we're using healthier ingredients and playing into all the different food issues. I mean, it sounds like he's hitting every kind of chord.
The mushroom space, ironically, is exploding right now with aptogens and other benefits. Never thought I would say that. But, you know, it's interesting if you can think about additional kind of product benefits, too, that can be layered in.
I like to taste it.
Sounds like this is a healthier way to do it, and sounds like a good alternative.
Should we take a vote?
Sure. Yeah.
Let's vote.
Great idea.
We are unanimous, four yeses. Let's open those doors.
Welcome to the board.
Do it.
Welcome.
How's it going?
All right, so why jerky, and can we try some?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Who wants teriyaki, sweet and spicy, original?
Spicy for me.
Yeah, I'll try teriyaki.
All right.
Thank you.
Here you go, it's original.
Love the packaging and branding.
Thank you.
Icons are great on the back.
Yep.
So why jerky?
Yeah, so I actually grew up in a vegan, primarily vegan household in Hawaii, and I've always been really into sustainability and caring about the earth. And fast forward, I went fully vegan in college and moved to San Francisco, working in a tech job, and I was looking for a vegan jerky. And I looked on the market, you know, Whole Foods, farmers markets, and there's really nothing, you know, out there that at least pleased me. So fast forward about 3 months, I had a pretty good prototype. I sampled it to family and friends. And then I came across a guy named Thomas Bowman, who was the head developer at Hampton Creek, now called Just. And he tried it, it was an informal lunch. And he's like, hey man, I can, you know, make this a lot better, make it commercial, shelf stable. And so started working with him last summer. And 6 months later, we came across a bacon jerky. And I mean, we love it. We're ready to share it with the world. So we actually haven't launched it. We launched in June.
And it does taste just like bacon,
yeah.
Right, Dave?
Yeah.
Do you think?
Yeah, without the meat. Great. Who is your lead investor?
I can't say. We're finalizing it right now.
So you really don't have sales at this point,
no
right?
Sales yet. So we're launching in June.
How'd you come up with a $4 million valuation?
Just talking to different people. Started a little higher, and they kind of pushed us down. So $4 million was what people were comfortable with.
Have you taken any investment in?
We got a commitment from one of the co-founders of Casper, but the lead investor, it's pending right now.
The $750,000.
Kevin, what do you, I mean, you're an expert in this product space. What do you think about the jerky space? And
well, I think there's probably a great niche there that is untapped, but I do have an issue with the valuation because you've got to go through a whole year to try to do $1 million in sales, and you're saying before that year even starts, you're valued at $4 million.
So the folks at Amazon told us that we should be doing $1 million on Amazon in the first year, which is a lot. That's why we're raising $1 million. They say to put 20% of the forecasted first year sales.
I'd be interested in investing if, on contingent, he closed the lead. I'm not gonna play around with evaluation guessing about a product that's not out and investors that aren't in, but if someone's willing to give you $750,000, I'll take the valuation that they take.
Yeah.
and take super pro-rata rights.
Yeah, I like that. And assuming we still have a focus around retail, because I think we're going to cap out with a direct-to-consumer model only.
Are you guys okay with us making an offer contingent on those two things with super pro-rata rights on the second round?
Yeah,
I'm okay.
I'm in, yeah.
All right, we're prepared to make an offer for $250,000 contingent upon you closing the lead at $750,000, matching the valuation, as well as giving us super pro-rata rights to the second round. Do we have a deal?
Let's do it.
Right on.
All right.
First up, welcome to the family.
Thank you.
It's awesome. They're all so nice. Love the product, which is always a plus when you go in there. They put a deal in that's contingent on our lead investor, which we're confident about. So then that's all I can ask for.
Are you ready for the next pitch? Let's listen.
Your 60 seconds begins now. Going up.
Hi, my name is Jacob Ogletree. I'm from West Palm Beach, Florida, and I'm the founder of Gush. Gush is an online e-commerce website that specializes in trends, beauty, and fashion, fast fashion. The online apparel industry did $1.3 trillion in 2018 and is forecasted to grow by another $100 billion in the next 2 years. What separates us from our competitors is our expertise and our just our in general vibe that we really love marketing and advertising.
No idea what he's talking
about. And with an expertise in social influence relationships and licensing contracts.
This stands for everything I stand against.
We're looking to raise $250,000 for 25% equity in the company for our first major round of funding. Thank you,
Five,
and I look forward to making
four,
our future shareholders
three,
very happy.
Two, one, time's up.
This is one of those pitches, I can honestly say, I have no idea.
Whatsoever. Trends, fashion, beauty, it is completely against everything the market is moving toward. This is all about conspicuous consumption, you know, materialism. The fashion industry in particular is trying to move away from this to a more conscious place. So to me, this flies in the face of everything we're trying to do from a trend standpoint. I don't like it at all.
I was waiting to hear about products. I mean, did he say products? I mean, like, that's what would get me excited, but it's trends and fashion.
It's a blog.
So I don't know where the monetization is.
I don't know what he's selling, but you know, all right, let's vote.
Let's do it.
Wow, we actually got a yes. That's three no's and one yes. Let's send him down.
Going down. Ooh.
Well, thank you so much. I felt like my pitch was pretty strong. I'd be curious to know why the investors didn't give me a chance to talk a little bit more. I'm an outgoing guy, like people like me, like it's all gonna happen. So not too really concerned.
I'm really excited to be on the show, to meet the investors, to present my company. And I'm really excited to just present the product to consumers and the US.
Who's ready to hear the next pitch?
Your 60 seconds begins now. Going up.
Are you still wasting hundreds, thousands of dollars on expensive coffee making equipment? Did you know that every year enough plastic coffee pots are produced to circle the earth more than 10 times? With 1 in 3 in American families owning a single serve coffee machine, there gotta be a better way. Well, how about this? Mulehouse Coffee is organic ground coffee in single serve portable pourover filters and 100% renewable packaging. All you need is hot water, and Mulehouse gets you a fresh cup of premium coffee anytime, anywhere. So, are you ready to brew up some magic? Because this hard deal is made to pour over returns. My name is Jonas. I'm the founder and CEO of Mulehouse Coffee, and I'm offering 20% in exchange for $250,000 investment in my company. We've launched in October of 2018, made an annualized $60,000 last year, $290,000 this year, grew Amazon month over month by 421%, and just got accepted into KeHE, one of the largest
Five,
US natural
four,
food distributors.
Three,
Mulehouse,
two,
coffee on your one. Terms.
I wonder what the quality of the coffee is, because people like, you know, I have a particular brand that I brew myself, and so I'm just thinking it's like an instant coffee, but he didn't talk at all about the quality.
It's interesting for those of us that travel a lot. you know, and are constantly on the go, I think there's an interesting opportunity from a financial standpoint, not all that appealing, but maybe we could help them.
I love businesses that are addictive, that don't cause cancer. I'd be interested in hearing more.
You guys ready to vote?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, we got some friendly judges. Four yeses. I want some coffee. Open those doors.
Welcome to the boardroom.
Woolhouse Coffee. Woo!
How are you guys?
Okay. Your synapses are clearly firing, so.
Very good.
You ready for us?
I'm totally ready.
Okay, good. Can we try some product?
Absolutely. Let me hand out. We have a few different flavors. I got a Vienna Melange, fruity and sweet for you.
Okay, great. Like.
Who likes decaf? Anyone decaf? Mm. You go, sir.
Thank you.
Strong Turkish coffee, anyone?
I'll take it.
Yes.
Right. I love it.
And I have left a kind of Wonder Outdoors or a CBD coffee.
I'll have the Outdoors, that's great. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So can you share a little bit about the origin story and what makes this unique?
Absolutely. So I'm originally from Germany. As a kid, I grew up traveling all the time by train with my parents through Southeastern Europe, Turkey. And I really always enjoyed like Turkish cafe houses. And when I moved to America and got into the corporate world, I wanted to combine a beautiful, delicious, organic coffee with something that allows you to have delicious coffee anytime, anywhere.
On Amazon, how many renewed customers do you have? So continual customers.
Yeah. So we grew this year, month over month, average of the first 2 months by 421%. About 60% of the customers that we have been buying on Amazon, and about 60% are coming back.
So just to put a finer point on Dave's question, specifically, how many customers do you have currently, who is that target?
So we have on Amazon a couple of hundred customers, 60% of our buying again, and we also have our website. And the target that we're looking for are people that are really into food, that are into travel.
Do you do any digital marketing at all, Facebook and Instagram, other places besides Amazon?
Yeah, so we're running Google, Facebook, and Amazon ads, small amounts right now, but they do yield some results.
And so it's roughly $10 for this packet of four?
So we sell it between $7.99 and $9.99 in retail stores.
Yeah.
Online, we sell bigger packs without the shipping cost.
How are you thinking, though, about national expansion? I mean, all of us are going to think about how does this scale within a Whole Foods or, you know, other kind of retailers. Direct to consumer, you're not really tranching there all that effectively. So how are you also thinking about kind of brick and mortar?
So what we did is, since November last year, we literally applied to about 280 large brands in the USA. So we got into the supplier portal. We did the same with the distributors. We got officially accepted into KE, which I think is a big deal. So I think we have a pretty good brand. We built some relationships. I have a really good sales guy that's kind of targeting those accounts. Then we get to production capacity. Right now, we can support about 78 stores. We're expanding pretty quickly. We can do about 500 stores that we can support right now, the current sales, with actually some automation that also reduced my labor cost. And with an investment of about maybe $20,000, I can probably get to 2,000 stores that I can support.
What do you guys think?
I think it's interesting. I mean, it's not a large investment, $250K for 20%. I think the 20% is a bit steep.
I'm on the fence, so I need somebody to convince me.
So first of all, I believe you're gonna be successful. This is your baby, and I think you're gonna power it through. But for right now, I don't feel it's the right time for us.
You need a bridge to get to proof of concept a little bit more without giving up too much of your company. Because you wouldn't want me to give you a $50,000 offer for 20%, and we won't want to take 50% of your company for $250,000.
Right?
Because it's
going to
cripple you. I think you're going to win. I agree with you, Mike. That's the kind of investor, entrepreneur I invest in. I just think you're a little bit too early.
Could we maybe discuss a small investment and maybe line of credit?
PO financing.
Well, PO financing. Why don't we do that? Absolutely.
I would think about putting $50,000 in with PO financing and what percent? 20%. We'll do 20%. So the offer is $50,000 plus PO financing with a credible PO.
Okay.
And for 20%.
Can we do a little bit more? Can we do maybe 100 and I'll give you maybe, let's say, 25%?
You're a shrewd negotiator. Maybe you should switch to professions of sports agentry.
Yeah, maybe 75?
Yeah, 75.
How's that?
Keep 420.
We'll split the difference.
Sounds good.
Yeah. Let's do it.
Okay,
good. So our offer to you is 20% of the company for $75,000, and we're going to give you PO financing against any credible PO. Do we have a deal?
Let's do it.
All right.
We got a deal.
All right.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Can we get coffee?
So we got a deal. 75K for 20% plus credible pure financing, which we really need because we're going to get some big orders from KE and other companies. My advice to other contestants would be a lot of passion, a lot of energy, good pitch, and drinking Moulin's coffee before you get in.
200,000 for the 15%, $200,000 for the debt financing with the ability to expand to 400,000.
We'll take it. I'm Iris.
I'm Calvin. And we're the founders of Honeybell.
Honeybell is a natural beauty brand that started in my kitchen, and we make natural skincare products for your face, lips, and body with effective natural ingredients.
So we pitched on season 3, ended up in the boardroom, getting a deal with the judges. However, something even bigger happened after that.
After being on Elevator Pitch, we made $1 million in sales. This year, we are doubling that, as well as expanding our team, sharpening up our retail presence, and developing our brand in the marketplace.
So when we pitched on the show, we were boyfriend and girlfriend, and one of the judges actually expressed concern about that.
The thing that I'm most intrigued about is their relationship. It's not necessarily a bad thing, but usually that is sometimes just a little bit of caution.
But Calvin took care of that by popping the question, and now we're engaged. This show really helped us realize that we're so much more stronger and powerful as a couple, not only in our personal lives, but also when we're pitching our business as well.
Elevator Pitch was incredible. Not only did we get great partnership, lessons learned for our company, but now we're also getting married.
So we just really want to thank the judges and...
If you want to invest in our honeymoon fund, the opportunity is open, so give us a call.
And now, perfecting the pitch from Sprint Business.
Rule number one is you've got to have your facts straight.
Back up your numbers. Don't go into a pitch promising big returns if you don't have the reasoning and math to support the numbers. Show exactly how you plan to reach your forecast.
Honesty is the best policy.
Sprint Business works for business. Check out sprint.com/elevator pitch.
All right, let's hear the next pitch.
Your 60 seconds begins now. Going up.
Hello, my name is Chuck. I'm an experienced and successful entrepreneur, and I want to tell you about my next big startup, Groovefox. Groovefox is a unique streaming music service dedicated to the millions of underserved people in the electronic dance music community. Now, indulge me for a second, if you will. If you were watching TV and you wanted to watch cartoons, would you go to Animal Planet? No, you'd go to Cartoon Network. That's very similar to a major issue in the streaming world today. Spotify, Pandora, Apple Music, and others do not provide what an electronic dance music fan is looking for. They lack in content and content curation, original content, cultural understanding, and many other issues. We've solved all of that by creating an entire ecosystem for EDM fans where they can listen to make playlists from hundreds of thousands of their favorite tracks, listen to incredible original content, podcasts from the biggest DJs and labels in the world. Now, this is not a pipe dream or an idea. We're up and running. We have subscribers. We have the music licensing, which is very difficult to acquire. And we're looking for strategic partners to invest $350,000 on an 18-month convertible note with $250,000 with a $2.5 million cap at a 20% discount. Thank you.
Rights and licensing is not my domain, very tricky territory. What do you guys think?
What I like about it is it's very specific niche. He has the rights to the music. For me, I'd be interested in understanding it more.
Yeah, we're investor in Spotify and amazing business. It's a tough business though.
Monetizing it.
I don't know, I wonder how many customers they have because it's gonna be really tough. You got all these, Jay-Z is now part of the new one called Tidal, I believe. And you know, they've had some challenges with what they've been doing. And I think they're doing okay now, but to go head to head with Spotify is probably a pretty tough undertaking.
And the question there would be, what would prevent a Spotify or others to just go into the space and end up striking these deals? I mean, it's only a matter of time.
All right, let's vote.
Let's do it. That's 3 no's, 1 yes. He's gonna have to dance his way down.
Going down.
I felt I fumbled on the pitch a little bit. I mean, I don't think that made that much of a difference. But you know, it is what it is. I didn't make it up there. I mean, there'll be more opportunities.
Your 60 seconds begins now. Going up.
Hi, I'm Kimberly, and I'm the founder of the friend-finding app, Standin. When your friends can't join you, you get a stand-in, because we have all been there. wanting to hit the city only to find none of our friends can join us. And we know you tried to get your friends to join you because the National Endowments of the Arts did a survey and 6.8 million people who wanted to attend an event but did not stated the reason was because I didn't have anyone to go with. And in comes Standin. Put your plans into the app. It's like sending a group message to your entire city to see who's in. Select from the people who want to join you and voila, you have a new BFF to hit the city with. Currently, there are no big players introducing new friends to go to events with. I plan on monetizing the app the same $500 million way dating apps do, which is free to use, but you pay for premium features. We're launched in Chicago, and my seed round ask is $80,000 for 20% in an advisory seat. So, who wants to stand in?
Time's up.
Good pitch, but my problem with all of these, it's like financial planners to athletes. Every financial planner wants an athlete and says they need protection. They all go bankrupt, right? The problem with every one of these apps is not the apps. There's plenty of opportunity. The people don't want to engage.
Okay. I think your point, Dave, is a really good one, which is to drive audience and also just credible, verified individuals who you would actually want to meet with. Like, what is the filtering process for that look like? And how do you have enough audience where this makes sense? So for me, it feels like it doesn't make sense.
And I don't know if she said, is she up and running yet?
In Chicago, but she didn't say
just
any
Chicago, because the acquisition cost of a customer in this world is very high. A lot of people just think, oh, we're going to launch the app and they're going to come. But it costs a lot of money to get people to download the app. It sounds like a stretch.
So it sounds like the core value proposition, meeting complete strangers, we're just not that into, but let's go ahead and vote just to be sure. Does that sound good?
Good idea.
Great.
Oh no, that's four no's. We gotta send her down.
Going down.
I had this great experience, so I didn't get let in, but I'm looking forward to seeing the playback, and that way I can hear the deliberation and see what I have to work on for next time.
Coming up on the next Entrepreneur Elevator Pitch.
The Petty Flop Sandal is a four-pronged toe-separating flip-flop able to use before, during, and after a pedicure.
I'm struggling a bit on the usage occasion.
I don't really see if there's a market.
I can't flip your opinion, so I'll flip your vote.
No comment.
And to apply for season 5, go to entrepreneur.com/elevator pitch.
What's up, guys? This is Matt from Moku. Since I finished filming on Elevator Pitch, my co-founder Steven and I have been busy meeting with investors across the country. And we've also been heads down working on our production at the manufacturing facility, which is close to being ready to get product out to the world. We're gonna be launching online and also in stores in San Francisco, LA, and New York. And we've also been meeting with influencers, artists, and athletes to help promote Moku once we launch soon. So we're excited to get this out there, and hopefully you guys can try the product soon. Cheers.